YouTube. We will wait a couple of minutes, Franco, if you're okay, and then we are ready to start.
Yeah. Okay.
Cool. Are you teaching virtual or not?
No, no, no.
No.
Yeah, in Pavia, and also I have activity in Macau.
Macau, yeah. So you stopped traveling to Macau? Previously, you was...
Yeah, not now, but I used to, yeah.
Yes.
Now there is a restriction, so I cannot travel.
Yeah.
But I also have a Zoom connection with these people sometime.
Yes. Yeah, that's the only option we have right now.
Yeah. Even in Paris, I'm going to the lab because you know I can do research activity, you know, with my former coworker. And I'm going in the lab, but not all the days. And maybe I go there only a couple of hours to limit the contact with people.
Yeah, well, that's some activity. Yeah, here is just starting this month. The university are reopening the labs in a wide way. I mean, because previously it was just very restricted access to mm-hmm. all the rooms and labs. So you need to do a lot of paperwork to get access. So yeah, now it's a merge between virtual plus presential.
Yeah, it's difficult. Anyway.
Okay. Yeah, we hope to have you back in Argentina next year or soon.
Maybe.
I met you on the Buenos Aires once because the circuit and system. So I think
that was a very good visit. I like that very much.
Yeah, that's good.
I had a very good stack.
Okay, I think we are ready, and so I will start the presentation. So you will share a screen later.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Welcome everyone. This is the last day of a conference, so we have two talks. Right now we have the talk from Professor Maloberti from University of Pavia. So Franco Maloberti received the Laurea degree in physics summa cum laude from University of Parma in 1968. And doctorate honoris causa in electronics from Institute of Astrofísica, Óptica y Electrónica from Puebla, Mexico in 1996. He was visiting professor on Swiss Federal Institute of Technology, then professor of AM University in Texas. Is also presently he is a professor of microelectronics and head of microelectronics integrated circuit system group from University of Pavia in Italy. So his professional expertise is in the design, analysis, and characterization of integrated circuits and analog digital application, mainly in the areas of switches, capacitor circuit, data converters, interfaces for telecommunication and sensor systems, CAD, analog, and A2D mixed design. He was writing more than 600 papers and on journals and conference proceedings, attend of books, holds 39 patents. So Dr. Maloberti has received, was the recipient of the 12th Pedrialli Prize. His technical and scientific contribution to national industry industrial production in 1992. He was a co-recipient of in 1996 from IEEE, Institute of Electrical Engineering Fleming Premium, the best paper award, and also in ESS CIRC in 2007, and the Best Paper Award in IEE Journal Analog Workshop in 2007 and 2010. He was president of IEEE Sensor Council from 2002 to 2003, and also of CAS Society from on 2095 and 2097. He was associate editor in IEEE TCAS. Well, he continued his work on the Sequence System Society. He received in 1999 the Meritorious Service Award, in 2000 the Golden Jubilee Medal, and IEEE Millennium Medal. He received the CAS Society Max van Valkenburg Award in 2013. He's an IEEE Fellow, and in 2009 he received a title of Honorary Professor of University of Macau, and he's currently the chairman of the Academic Committee of Microelectronics in Key Lab on Macau. He was the president of CAS recently in 2016 and 2017, and past president during 2018 and 2019. So for us, it's a pleasure to have Professor Maloberti on this talk. We have this virtual, and we are taking advantage of the possibility of invite you to have this session. So thank you very much, and we will glad to have you here. Thank you, Professor.
Thank you very much for the presentation. I'm sharing the screen. Okay. Do you see the screen?
Yes, very well. You can go full screen.
Okay, that's full. Okay, that's it.
Yes. Great.
Okay, let me also have another pointer. Okay, so as you see, you know, my presentation is on a single inductor, multiple output DC converter for portable power management. The agenda of my presentation is this one. I will give before an introduction of the portable power management. And I will very briefly mention the LDO, but the main focus is on inductive converters, so the DC-DC converter that are using inductor. And after that, we go into the main topic of the presentation, that is how to obtain more than one output voltage with a DC-DC converter that is using only one inductor. And here we have three possible categories: one single inductor double output, single inductor multiple output, or single inductor bipolar output. Let's see, you know, portable power management is a very important topic at the moment. That is, you know, the way we provide the power to portable devices, portable system. And, you know, the portable electronics electronics for portable devices is important because, you know, one of the goals is to have a very long life of the battery. And also it's important to have the possibility to recharge your battery in a relatively short period of time. Another category of system is the autonomous system, that are systems that are not able to recharge the battery with a conventional way. So in this system, they have the need to harvest the power from the environment. Another important issue when you talk about this topic is that the size and the weight of the power system must be as small as possible. And another thing that we have to address is the need of the so-called wearable electronics. That means electronics that can be on the body of a person or inside the body of the person, as we have here, You know, we have a very small system that is made by an electronic stimulator that is implanted direct in the heart of a person. Another big category of possible user of portable power management are the so-called devices of the Internet of Things application. And Internet of Things means that we have systems that are connected with the world through internet. And many of these are portable or autonomous. One of the trends that we have at the moment is to have a system that are directly integrated into a single die of integrated circuit. So we have a system on chip, or eventually we have the system that is in a package. For this two kind of system, we have the requirement of power that is very dynamic. Here we have different units like execution unit, fixed function, or you can have you know, media units. And all of them can be in a different possible status. We can have high demand, low demand, or retention. So depending on this, what we have to do is to provide, you know, the power to these blocks depending on the request. And typically, you know, in order to increase the power that you deliver to the block, what you have to do is to increase or to reduce, to increase the power, the voltage of the supply. And in order to have the optimal supply voltage, you know, the system can be organized in this way. Here we have a battery or source of energy. After that, here we have a DC-DC converter that is a way to obtain a conversion of the input voltage into another output voltage with a very high efficiency. And after that, you can have LDO that are determining a drop between this noisy voltage to another voltage that is lower, but with a very smaller ripple. So we have a quiet voltage here and a noisy voltage here, but the drop must be small. So you see that here, if you have that the load are requiring more or less the same output voltage, you can use only one DC-DC converter. And after that, we have a separate LDO serving the different load of your system. But in many cases, you can have you know, a group of load that are working with a voltage, it may be 1.2 volts, and another group of load that are working with different voltage, maybe 0.8. So in this case, you know, if you have here 0.4, you will have a drop of 200 millivolts from here to here. But here, if you have a 1.4, you go down to 0.6, you have a bigger drop, and the efficiency that you have on this load is much less. So the possible solution is to use on the chip multiple DC-DC converter that are generating the voltage that is used to serve separate groups of loads. In this way, you will have the good efficiency of the DC-DC converter, and you have the advantage of the LDO that is generating a quiet voltage at the output. Okay, that's what we have. Let's see, you know, the LDO, very briefly, what is the operation of this block? Typically, you know, in a CMOS technology, what you use is to have an element that is determining a drop voltage between the input and the output. And this drop voltage is obtained with a PMOS or NMOS transistor. And, you know, the control of the transistor that you have here is obtained by comparing a fraction of the output voltage with the reference that you have. And this difference is the error that you have. And the amplification of this error is controlling the transistor that is determining the drop voltage. So see here that you can have the PMOS implementation, and you have the NMOS implementation. Probably you know that the mobility of the NMOS transistor is better than the mobility of PMOS transistor, so the W over L of the transistor that we have here is smaller than the W over L of the transistor that we have here. And also, you know, here we have feedback loop. And you know, the feedback loop that you have is determined by the number of poles that you have around the loop. So you see that here we have an amplifier plus the amplification of the error amplifier. So for this kind of solution, you know, the stability is more difficult to control than in this case. Another observation that you have is that, you know, here you need maybe an n-channel transistor. And from here to here, you have an n-channel. From here to here, you need a threshold voltage plus the overdrive of this transistor. So the voltage here is VGS higher than the output. And in this case, you know, the maximum voltage you can obtain here is the V input. So you will have a relatively large draw from this point to this point. So you see that, you know, the solution that you have here is more convenient than the other one. But here we have the issue of the stability. Another possible solution is that instead of using, you know, the analog control of the transistor you have here, it is possible to have a digital control of the transistor you have here. And this is done in the so-called digital LDO. And, you know, with this solution, you can have a very low overhead between these two points. And in order to have that, you know, this transistor will be in the triode region. What you do, you know, in order to obtain the output voltage is not to control the voltage of this transistor, but we have many of this transistor in parallel and to decide how many of these transistors are switched on. So you'll have that, you know, this solution here is like a current generator, and you decide how many of this elementary current generator switching on in order to provide the current that multiplied by the resistance of the load obtained the output voltage. So the digital LDO will be given by a loop control that is deciding how many of this transistor are switched on in order to obtain the target voltage at the output. So this is what you do with LDO, but before that, we have the DC-DC converter. And you know, the DC-DC converter, that is the structure that is giving a very good efficiency, is the one based on inductor. Let's see what is the basic idea of this kind of DC-DC converter. Suppose that you have a given voltage and you want to generate a voltage that is lower than that one. And what you can do is using a switch, you can obtain a square wave like this one. So during a period, a fraction of the period of the time TS, so for DTS, you have the switch is connected to this position here, and the output voltage is the voltage of the battery. During the other part of the period, you connect this to ground, and you have zero. So the action of this switch is to generate a square wave like this one, and you understand that the average of this square wave is something lower than the input voltage, and the value depends on the duty cycle. So if your duty cycle is, for example, 50%, you will have an average of 0.5 the voltage of the battery. If you want to obtain from this waveform a constant voltage or almost a constant voltage, what you have to do is to put here in the middle, you have to put a filter that is rejecting the high frequency component of this square wave. In that way, you obtain in some way the averaging of the waveform. The point is that you know, the filter that you have to use is consuming power. So you'll have a reduction of the efficiency. So the solution that you can use is to use the non-dissipative element that are realizing the filter. So you see that here, we realize the filter using an inductor and the capacitor that are ideally non-consuming power. So in this way, the filter that you see is not consuming power, and you can have an efficiency of the generation of the lower voltage here that can be 100%. In the reality, we'll have a loss in the switches. We have some loss in the inductor. We have some loss here. So the efficiency is not able to go to 100%. But you know, if you have a careful design, you can have a very good efficiency in the order of 80 or 90%. Actually, you know, we have not only this kind of structure that is obtaining a voltage at the output that is proportional to the duty cycle. So it's going from zero, if the duty cycle is zero, to the voltage of the input when the duty cycle is 100%. But also you can have other possibility, you know, for example, in this case, you see that you have the two switches on the other side of the inductor. And in this case, we have the so-called boost converter. And the boost converter is able to obtain a voltage at the output that is bigger than the voltage at the input. And you see that, for example, if the duty cycle is 80%, you can have the voltage at the output that is five times the input voltage. So you see there that, you know, the boost converter is operating this way. During a period of time, you charge the inductor, you put energy on the inductor, and during the other phase, the energy stored in the inductor is boosting, you know, the voltage that you have here and transfer the voltage on the capacitor, so the voltage is going up. Another possibility you can have is to obtain negative voltages. So this is realized by injecting into the load the current that you have in the inductor in the opposite direction. So you see that here, the current is flowing in this way. And after, you know, you have the connection of the other terminal to the inductor. In this case, you have the voltage that you obtain and the output is negative. Okay. Let's wait a couple of minutes on the current that you have in the inductor. And you see here that in order to understand that, you have to use this very well-known equation that is telling that the voltage across an inductor is proportional to the derivative of the current. So if, for example, you consider the first structure, the buck converter, you see that during the phase one, when the switch is connected here, the differential voltage across the capacitor is given by the voltage of the battery minus the voltage on the output. So if you suppose that the output of the generator is almost constant, you will have a constant drop voltage across the inductor. And because of this, you will have that the current will go up with a given slope, given by VG minus V output divided by inductor. When you close the switch in the position two, you will have that the voltage across the inductor is the output voltage with a sign minus. So we'll have that the current will go down with a slope that is minus V divided by L. And if you are in the steady state condition, the current that you have on this point is equal to the current that you have on this point. You can do a similar study, you know, for the second architecture. We have the boost converter. And again, you have that when the position of the switch is one, you will have this circuit. When the switch in the position two, we have this circuit. And you see that again, you have in one case a positive slope. And after that, you have a negative slope to go down to the same level. Actually, you see that here, you know, the DC level of the current can be any value. So what is the request from this equation is that we have this ramp up and ramp down. So the average can be to any level, and this level depends on the current that is required by the load. So if the load is a very small resistance, this current will go up. And if the load is a small resistance, this current, this waveform will go down. But you can have at a given moment that you know, the current will become zero And you can have another way of operating the buck convert, the boost converter, that is a discontinuous mode. So in the discontinuous mode, the current is starting from zero, going up, and after going down, and after remaining zero for a period of the a fraction of the period. Okay, let's see now what is the goal that you have. The goal that we have is to design a DC-DC converter that is able to generate two or more output voltages, and we have to use only a single inductor. The reason is that, you know, the inductor is the bulky element. So it may be, you know, in your system, you have a capacitor and inductor. The capacitor is normally very small, and the inductor is not a good component. So the reason of having an inductor on the system is that you have a good efficiency, you have good performances, but your people don't like very much to have inductors. So the idea is, okay, let's see if we can use a single inductor to generate more than one output voltage. You know, it's possible to obtain this result by using a time sharing of the current of the inductor. So the idea is that we have a given current in the inductor, and we send that current on one of the load during a fraction of the period. You send that in another load, another fraction of the period, and so forth. So we use you know, the current, and we serve that current, and with that current we serve different loads. The problem is that you know, the system must be able to operate with a good efficiency. And the issue that we have to study is what is the good strategy, you know, for this time sharing of the current. You know, the level of the output voltage is controlled by a feedback loop. In this case, we have multiple feedback loop. And also we have other practical issue like how do you drive the switch and how we can protect the switches. Let's go a little bit back, you know, on the issue of the time sharing. If you have a conventional DC-DC converter, what you need is to define a duty cycle. But if you have two output DC-DC converter, you need to decide what is the duty cycle, but also you have to decide at what time you have the change from the load one to the load two. If you have n output data converter, you need again the control of the duty cycle where the inductor is connected to in one configuration or the other configuration, but also you need n minus one sharing times. So you see that if you increase the number of output, you have a large number of switching time that you have to determine. And this determination must be able to ensure the stability of the system. Okay, let's see, you know, how and when, you know, I started addressing this problem. The first time was in 2005. At that time I was in the United States, in Texas. And I had a number of PhD students coming from Texas Instruments. And one of them came to me and said, okay, in my department, we are studying, you know, the DC-DC converter that is used to drive white LEDs. And, you know, for a white LED, the illumination depends on the current that you have on the LED. So if you put many LED in series like here, you'll have a constant illumination. But if you put many LED in parallel, you will have that the illumination is not constant, not uniform, because we have a mismatch between the threshold voltage that we have on the different diodes. But the problem that you have here is that the supply voltage that you need is n times the voltage you have to apply across one diode. And you know, the voltage that you have here can become large with respect to the voltage that you have on the chip. So you need a boost converter that is pushing up the current, the voltage, you know, from a low level to a high level. So the architecture that you eventually can use is to have, you know, a way to measure the current that you have in the LED. And after, you know, in a feedback loop, you determine what is the output voltage. The issue is that in some cases, you have more than one white LED on the chip, on the system. And actually, you know, at that time, you know, the request was to have a separate control of two series of white LEDs. And the idea was, okay, let's do that with a single inductor and to have a boost converter that is using this architecture. So you see that here, the inductor, during one phase, we charge the inductor, we put energy here, and after you close the switch to provide the energy, you know, to the load one, A, and after that, you provide energy to load B. You know, the problem can be solved using two different strategies. And one strategy is to say, okay, I have during one cycle of the operation of this circuit, we serve the load A, and during the other cycle, we serve the load B. So to have alternate operation in the two loads. If you do that, you see that, you know, the load A is receiving current and energy with this time distance. And during this period of time, the voltage of the load A is sustained by the capacitor that we have on this point. Another solution is to have, you know, to have, you charge the inductor, you put energy on the inductor, and after you serve the load A, and when the load A is satisfied, you charge the load B. So the idea is to have a solution where we have, during one clock period, you have, you provide the energy to both loads. And that solution was actually better than the other one because the peak of the current that you have here is lower than the peak of the current we have on the other solution here. So we decided to use this strategy, and you know, the circuit that we designed is realizing the function that we have in the previous slide. You have the inductor. During one period of time, we charge the inductor through these two switches. Actually, here we have two transistors, and you know, for one of them, we measure the current, and you have only a fraction of the total current is flowing here, and the other current is flowing here. So we have a better efficiency because of the power consumption to measure the current, and. Here we have, you know, the connection to the two separate loads that are made by the series connection of these two. And here you see that we have the measure of the current in the load A and measure of the current in the load B. what we have done here is, you know, to study the way to control the two time. One is the switching of the inductor. So we charge the inductor until this time. And after we serve the load A, and after here, we serve the load B until the current is going to zero. So in this way, in this solution, we have the discontinuous mode of operation. You know, the method that we have used to decide these two times was extremely simple. And actually, you know, one was, you know, to check, you know, what is the need of current by the two loads. And this is done, you know, measuring, you know, the voltage we have on this point and this point. So if the current that you have here is lower than you expect, you know, the voltage you will drop down. If the voltage on the second low is lower, this voltage will drop down. And after that, we compare this with the two setting. And here we decide, you know, the circuit that is demanding more power. So if the voltage that we have here is lower than the one that we have here, depending on the setting, we say, well, this load is asking more power. So because of this, we increase the time at which, you know, you switch the inductor. So increase the energy we put on the inductor. After that, we have to decide when we have to switch from the load A to the load B. And that decision is based on a very simple observation. So you look at the voltage on the point here, that is the current on this load. And when the voltage is reaching the selection, we switch on the other one. So what we do on this circuit is to say, okay, the load A is served before. And when the load is happy, and because the voltage is reaching the level, we provide the remaining part of the energy on the inductor to the second load. That is a very simple and not very precise way, you know, to control the switching between one load and the other. But the solution was good, and we had something like around 83% of efficiency when we have only one LED. And the efficiency is going down to around 80% when we have two white LED. And you see that here we have the two with 10 milliamp and 28 milliamp in the, of current in the two LED. Okay, this is you know, the solution that we have used for obtaining voltages that are bigger than the battery. When I returned back to Italy, I had cooperation with Auster Microsystem, and with them we had this project to generate two output that are lower than the voltage of the battery. The advantage of using two output for the boost converter is that you see that you have the inductor is connected to a switch that is going to zero or to the load. So if you have if you want to have a second load, what you have to do is just to put another switch that is connecting the load here, and you put the second load that is time sharing, you know, the current of the inductor. If you want to do that here, you see that where you have to open this point here and you put another load here. So if you want to have time sharing of the current in the buck converter, you need to put another switch in series with the current on the other side on the inductor. And this is what it was necessary to do in the circuit that we designed with Auster Microsystem. And, you know, this paper was presented at the ASSCC in 2007. So you see that here we have the switching of the inductor between battery and zero. And on this part, we have the switching between one load and the other. What we have done here is, you know, to decide a more precise or accurate way to control the two switching times. And actually, you see that, you know, the switching between a battery and ground on the battery side is obtained with information that are coming from the load one, while the switching between one load and the other is obtained by the information we have from the load two. So in this case, we have that, you know, the load one is controlling the switching on the battery side, and the load two is controlling the switching on the load side. On this circuit, we have a problem on the choice of the switches. So if you have here, you know, a switch connected to the battery voltage, you know, this transistor can be naturally a p-channel transistor, and this one can be an n-channel transistor. But here, you know, the situation is different because here we have the voltage of the load one, and the voltage of the load one depends on the request that you have on the circuit. So here, you know, we have three possibilities. One, to use an NMOS transistor, to use a PMOS transistor, or to use a pair of NMOS and PMOS to realize a pass transistor. Depend on the specification of your circuit, and if you know the voltage you want to generate is not becoming very low, you know, you can use maybe p-channel transistor. If the voltage is very low, you can use n-channel transistor, or you can use a pass transistor. In our circuit, you know, we had the use of p-channel transistor, and in that case, you know, one additional problem is how we bias the well. So we have the transistor in the well, and we have to decide where we bias the well. And you see here that depending on the condition of operation, you can add that the voltage of the one side of the switch can be bigger or smaller than the voltage on the other side of the switch. So what we have done on this circuit is to have a dynamic biasing of the well that depends on the sign of the on the voltage we have on the two sides of the switch. This circuit has been designed using conventional 0.35 CMOS technology with 5 volt option. And you see that here we have used 35 microfarad off chip, and also inductor is off chip. Let's see now. The efficiency of this was good. It was 85%, if I remember well. If you go to more than two outputs, you know, the problem of the control of the stability is much more serious. See, here we have used a very simple way to say, okay, one time is controlled by the error of one output, the other time is an error of the second output. That is not so bad. But we have, when you have more than two output voltages, you have to control three or four or five, whatever you have, time, switching time. So the situation is different. So what you can do is that the problem that you have to solve is represented by this equation. So we have the time one is something that is determined by the linear combination of all the error that you have in the output voltages. The time two is the same. Time n is this one. So what you can do is that, you know, the relationship between the error of the generated voltage and the switching times are related by a set of equation that is supposed linear equation. So we suppose that you have a linear relationship between time and error. And you know, the set of equations represented in this way. Actually, you know, the accuracy of the time will be better and better when you increase the gain of the loop. So we have this factor here is given by something proportional to the error, but that, you know, the error must be amplified like you have in a normal control loop. The issue that you have to discuss here is how we choose the matrix A. And here we have an infinite number of possibilities. The only request is that you know, you can solve this system. And one very simple way is to say that you know, the time one is controlled by the error one, time two, the error two, time three by the error three, and so forth. So the matrix of coefficient is something like this. At diagonal with only one, but also can have a more complicated possibility. One is that you have 1, 1, 1, 1. For example, you have four outputs. The second one is 1, -, -, 1, ±, -, ±, ±. So can have something like this. And you know, the determinant of this matrix is not zero, so you have a solution. So let's see what is the meaning of this choice matrix. There's the one that we have used for outputs. Is the following. Suppose that you know, the T1 is the switching between ground and the battery of the inductor. So if you have that the addition of the four arrow is positive, that is an information that the system needs more energy. So that means that you have to move, you know, the switching time to a higher level. If the addition of the four arrow is lower than zero, the system needs less energy. So X1 should decrease. So using this combination of coefficient here, that means that, you know, and you associate T1 to the switching time of the inductor, that means that, you know, we serve the system giving more energy when all the load are needing energy, all of them, or, you know, the addition of the error is positive. Let's see the second equation, and eventually you can associate the second equation of the switching between one load, load one and the load two. So you see that if the error that you have in the first load is bigger than the addition of the error in the other three, that means that he is really requiring energy, because you know, the error that is generating is bigger than the negative error that we have on the other one. So when you have this condition, you have to increase the switching of the first load, and so forth. So you see that you know, the choice that you have here is can be described in terms of satisfaction of energy from a different load of your system. So if you have maybe four outputs, so you will have that you know, the current in the inductor, you know, will go up when the inductor is connected to the VDD, and will go down when the inductor is connected to ground. So you see that, for example, you know, the switching of this two transistor is at this time. So we have the voltage will go up until that point, and that will go down after that. So you see that, you know, if the load one is switched at this time, the current that you have in the in this terminal is going up together with this one, and after you go to zero. And after you start again here, and so forth. This is the switching time between load 2 and load 3. So we have that the current in the load 3 will be, you know, the fraction of that we have here. This is load 2, sorry. Load 1, load 2. The load 3 is this one. So see that, you know, the current is going up at this point. But here we have the switching from VDD to ground. So we have that the current is starting going down like this. And finally, you have the load 4 is receiving the current, you know, in the last period of time. So what you have to do is to implement, you know, this coefficient, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 minus, 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 and so forth. And this was done in an integrated circuit that was published in 2008, SCC. And that was a cooperation that I had with National Semiconductor. And you see that here we have, you know, the first line of the matrix. This is the second line of the matrix, third and fourth line of the matrix. After that, we have amplification. And here we have transformation of the error, amplified error, into the time with the PWM. You know, since we have a feedback loop, we have to ensure stability. And actually, you know, the problem that we have in this kind of circuit is that, you know, the stability of the main loop, when you switch from one load to the other, the stability issue is not important, because what you do is just to change the load. So more or less, you know, the transfer function is changing, but is not generating a serious problem. So because of this, you know, we had to use a given a filter on this level in order to ensure the stability of the loop. The implementation of the function that you have here was done using a switched capacitor solution. And you see here that you have during the phase one, you connect this in the unity gong configuration. And during the phase one, you precharge this capacitor to the output voltage 1, output voltage 2, output voltage 3, output voltage 4. After that, we open the switch and we connect this terminal to the setting. So if you have a difference between the output voltage and the setting, you will generate a delta V. And this delta V will produce an injection of charge into this capacitor. So here you see that we have error 1, error 2, error 3, error 4. And you know, we have the same capacitance here, so the weight is 1. And here we have another capacitor determining the gain. Here we have the filter that is only for the first part. And at the output here, we have a double sample and hold that is ensuring that the output a constant voltage that is constant during the half clock period, but is remaining always at a given level. One of the issues that is interesting for this project is, you know, how to drive the switches. So the architecture is something like this. We have the main switches between VDD and ground. We have the inductor, and also we have the switch that are going on the load 1, load 2, load 3, and load 4. And you see that, you know, the switches are big. You have 30 millimeter with the length of 0.5 micron. So a very large aspect ratio. And this is because we are using n-channel transistor. So we understand that using a p-channel transistor, the situation is worse because the mobility of the PMOS is less than the mobility of the NMOS. The idea that we have used on this circuit is that, you know, the control of the gate of this switch is obtained by a voltage that is boosted up. So if you want to close this switch, here we apply a voltage that is bigger than VDD because a boost effect. And the boost, and the boost is obtained by using the current that you have in the inductor during the these overlap phases, between when we open this switch and this switch. So you cannot have these two switches closed at the same time, because otherwise we have a short circuit between these two outputs. So what you have to do is to open this switch before, and after you close this switch, and after you open this switch before and you close this switch, you open this switch before and you close this switch. So we have a given period of time during which there is no connection to the output. So we exploit this period of time to push the current of the inductor into a capacitor through a diode. So because of this, the voltage that we have here will go up. So we have a boost of the voltage here because we are using the current of the inductor during the disorder phases. Okay, this is the microphotograph of the circuit. You see that here we have the four switches, the N-channel and P-channel transistor on the inductor side, and this is the control. The technology was a 0.5 micron CMOS technology, and the active area is relatively large, 3.5 multiplied by 3.8 millimeter. And you see that, the area of the switches are more or less equivalent to the area of the control. So you see that, this circuit was possible to have a total output current is going up to 1.8 ampere, and a single output current can go to 0.8 ampere. And the peak efficiency, you see that is good, 85%, is better than competitors that published a similar result with multiple output. So in this case, we have five output, two output, five output. And you see that here, this is our boost converter. And the boost converter are more good to design because you don't have the need to have extra switches, for the load. That is what I mentioned before. The advantage of this circuit is that here we have a relatively small inductor with the same output capacitance. This is because of the switching frequency, that is 3 mega, that is bigger than the switching frequency of the other. These are some details on the waveform that we measured. And here you can observe that, for example, when the output voltage on one load is changing from 0.7 to 1.6, we have different impact on the voltage on the other ones. So you see that load number one is here, is changing a little bit. Number two is changing less, and number four is changing like this. So we have a different effect on the four different loads. Okay. More recently, I had another project that was the request from STMicroelectronics. The idea is, to have the power management serving the power stage of a car radio. The car radio is imposing some strange condition. Because, you know, during the operation of the car, you have that the battery can can generate a voltage that is very high, or the voltage that you have, the output can be very large because we have some resonance. So the voltage can go up to many volts. And so the battery can go to 40 volts, for example. And also, you know, when you start the car, you know, you have a very big drop of the battery of the voltage. So the battery can go down to 4 volts. So the request was to generate a DC-DC converter able to operate with a voltage going from 4 to 40 volts. If you have in your car radio, if you have a class D amplifier, you know, you have to control, you know, the voltage that you have here, you know, from zero to the battery voltage with a sequence of pulses like this one. And, you know, we have the speaker is working there. But the idea is that, you know, if you use N-channel transistor here, you can have, you know, a more effective use of the silicon area. Because, you know, if you have that the voltage controlling the N-channel is suitable, you can use a smaller W over L on this transistor and also on this transistor. So the request was to have a voltage that is exceeding the battery voltage in a way that you can use N-channel transistor. So the request was to have the battery plus 6.5. Another request was to have maybe 4.5 volt that was used somewhere in the chip. But also, you know, they need 1.8 volt because we have a digital part of the circuit that is using this voltage. The problem that you have is that when the input, the voltage of the battery is dropping down, you know, it may happen that, you know, the voltage 1.8 that you have is becoming too small and the digital part is not working properly. So the request was to have 1.8 volt, but this 1.8 volt was floating around the battery voltage divided by 2. So the idea, the request was to have VDD divided by 2 plus minus 0.9. So in this way, you know, when the battery voltage is going down, you know, the 1.8 volt is not becoming too small. So it's like having a spring, you know, something like that. And the efficiency requirement of this was better than 80%. The solution that we have used is the one shown in the circuit. So we have the switching of the inductor on this side. And after, you know, the current in the that we have in the inductor is serving the high voltage. So we have a boost here. And also here, the 4.5 volt regulation here. And you see that in order to have the 1.8 volt floating, we have, you know, this, you close this switch in this way. So we have that, you know, the voltage that we have across this capacitor here is floating. And, you know, that was the first time that we had a solution with a floating voltage. I think that I have to speed up a little bit, right? Okay. So this is the, some detail on the circuit. And here we have used a driver, you know, for the several transistors. We have used an N-channel transistor with the boost. Okay, this is the challenge that I already mentioned before. You know, during the operation, you know, the voltage can go down to 4 volts or can go up to 40 volts. The error processing was done with a continuous time solution. So you see that here we have integration. The circuit was realized using a 110 nanometer BCD process. And the inductor, we had only one external inductor of 10 microhenry and external capacitor of 10 microfarad. And here you see that, you know, the voltages, profile voltage we have generated at our measured results. The last circuit that I want to discuss with you is a project that we done recently. And the paper has been published on the journal Solid State Circuit. Actually, you know, yesterday I received a notification that the paper is available online. And this is the title and the reference. The basic idea of this single inductor multiple output converter is to provide the voltages that are required by an active matrix or organic LED. An organic LED use typically, you know, 10 volt across the LED, and this 10 volt are provided in a bipolar manner. So we have that we have a positive voltage that is bigger than the zero, and we have negative voltage, and the positive voltage is used to control the operation of the organic LED, and the negative voltage is used to control the brightness. And you know, the request of this kind of supply voltages is that you need to have a very quiet positive voltage, and the ripple in the positive voltage much more important than the ripple in the negative voltage that you want to generate. The conventional solution are one, of course, to use two DC-DC converter. One is generating the positive voltage, one is generating negative voltage, or to use a single inductor bipolar output voltage. And one possible solution is, for example, this one. We have a circuit, we have during one phase we charge the inductor, during another phase we generate the negative voltage, and during another fraction of the phase we generate the positive voltage. So we have, you know, the generation of the negative before and positive after, or you can do the other way around, you have negative and positive. The problem that we have with all this solution is that the ripple of the positive supply is not satisfactory. Can be larger than the ripple on the negative supply, or even it is comparable, you know, the solution is not good. The idea that I had was, you know, to have generation of the floating voltage. So the idea was not to have a separate generation of the positive and the negative, but to generate the full voltage, the 10 volts. And after, you know, to have an anchor on the positive one in the way that if you have a ripple, that ripple is transferred to the negative side. So the idea is that what you do is to control the converter using a floating generation of a voltage. And after that, we fix the positive one to what you want to obtain. In this way, you know, the ripple on the positive side is much, much lower than the previous solution. This is the schematic, the complete schematic of the design that we have. And, you know, you can see here that we have the two modes of operation. During one phase, we charge the inductor, And during the other phase, you see that we disconnect the battery and you have this loop that is generating a floating voltage between these two points. And here we have this capacitor and we have some way, you know, to control the voltage on this point. And this capacitor is anchoring, you know, the positive voltage to the voltage across this COP. In this way, you know, the ripple is mainly affecting the negative terminal. Of course, we have possible limits. And here we have a description of this limit. So we can have that, you know, it is impossible, you know, to close the switch or open the switch at the same time. So what we have to do is to decide the sequence to avoid that, you know, we have short circuit. So what happened is that, for example, in order to charge the inductor, we open, we close this switch before, then this one, and because of this, we have the current in the inductor is going on the on this load here. And when you are in the other direction, we can have a current flowing this way. And also we have a problem of the parasitic capacitances. All this problem has been resolved in the circuit using you know, the complicated architecture that you see here. So you see that from this diagram that we have here, that the voltage on the positive side is very quiet signal. In the negative side, we have big ripple here. So this is not important. And you see here that the efficiency that we obtain can go up to almost 90%, 89.3% is the peak. That is when the input voltage is 4.5 volt. Okay, I think that it's time to close. I hope that you have been able to appreciate some of the point of this presentation. I understand that you know, the details are difficult to understand, but it may be that using the references you can improve the knowledge. You know, the size of this presentation is relatively big, so it may be I can send to Pedro, you know, a copy of the slide, and if you want to have this copy, you can just ask to him, or I don't know if you can put the slide on the some website. But as I know, also we have the video of this presentation. You can go through that.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much, Franco, and very nice presentation. I think it was very complete across different solutions on single inductor side. So we have a couple of questions from the YouTube streaming. So first question is, how a low transient on the on one output can affect the stability of the other output?
We have, for example, in the four outputs, you have here. You see that, you know, if the voltage that you have on one channel is changing from 0.7 to 1.6. You see that, you know, we have a different effect on the other channels. And that depends on the choice of the channel in the sequence. So if you have that, the channel number one is changing, you see that, you know, we have that the last channel, the number four, is more affected than the other one. Actually, you know, when we designed this circuit, we had to control carefully, you know, this problem. So the cross effect can be a limit. But, you know, as you see, you know, we have a relatively small variation of the output voltage. Yeah. So that is an important problem. Yes.
Yeah, in practice, we don't see much disturbance on the other outputs. So yeah. I think the other question is related to this. Thanks for the talk. And this student asked, you added a zero pole compensation to the error processing of the first output. Is that enough to ensure the stability of all the outputs? I think related to the to this one.
I think is, you know, the idea for this project, and also, you know, for the other one with ST Microelectronics, the idea was to use a simple, to use a simple zero pole compensation. Of course, you know, it depends on the use of the converter. You know, person that are working on this area decide what kind of control we have to use depending on the use of the converter itself. So in this case, we have used only, you know, a simple zero pole compensation, but eventually you can use a more complicated compensation. I don't remember, let me check. Maybe there is also, okay, here in this one. Yeah. The compensation here is more complicated. You can see this one. So the compensation that you have in the main loop is with this circuit, we have not a zero pole. We have, I don't remember what is the name of this one. Okay, this is the PID control, is this one, okay.
I see. Good. Related to the zero pole, a question for me is, I missed some part of how you feed the integrated error to each duty cycle or each period of the switch. How you do that?
No, I know that.
Because you, I think when in your previous slide with the switched capacitor filtering the zero poles, okay. So you integrate all the errors from each output.
No, it's not integrated.
It's not integrated. Okay.
Not integrated. But, so during the phase one, you discharge this capacitor. So you have that, you know, the voltage on the output here is, this is an amplifier.
Correct. So,
during the phase one, you discharge the capacitor. And during the phase two, you inject the difference on this capacitor here. So the voltage we have on this point, okay, anyway, the water on this point will be zero, and after you go to the value, zero, to the value, the zero, and so forth. So we have zero during the phase one and the signal during the phase two. So what you hear after that, you know, you inject, you know, the voltage that you have on the output here into this second stage that is realizing the filter. And here we have that during the phase one, you discharge this capacitor, and during the phase two, we inject, you know, the voltage that you have on this point. So here we don't need a switch because, you know, the voltage we have on this point is going from zero to the signal, zero signal. So we don't need a switch here. So this is a switched capacitor resistance injecting this structure here that is a filter. This resistance and equivalent switched capacitor resistor capacitor. And after that here, we have the double sample and hold that is sampling the output voltage when you have the signal here during the phase A, and you hold that, you have a flip around of this signal. So during the phase B, you know, you bring the voltage on this one and you see that we have this solution. So this switch capacitor structure is realizing the combination of the four inputs with the all the positive sign. For the other channel, we don't have this circuit here, but we have the sign is changing. So what you do is reverse the connection that we have between these 2 points, for example, and the sign here becoming minus. So we have plus before and becoming minus. So in this way, we have a way, you know, to very easily invert the sign to have this different combination. So we have plus, 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 plus in the main circuit like this, to have minus, minus, minus here. We invert this to connection, this to connection, this to connection. I don't know if that is clear.
Yeah. So you have a one circuit per voltage at the output. Can you go back to the slide of errors?
Yeah, this you know, the volt that we have here is used with a triangle wave generator to generate the time. The
volt. I see. Correct. Correct. So let me check if you have more questions. Okay. So the last question from me, Lisa, is on the latest years, we see some of the on-chip inductors and I mean of large sizing using some processes that are not a standard CMOS. On the other side, I noticed that there is an options that are kind of on package solutions to do system in package with the DC converter at the side of the SOC. So is this being used on that kind of solutions, the on chip and on package?
Okay, you know, the problem of on package is the size of the inductor and the size of the capacitor. What I have done, it was some years ago, is you know, to try to have a reduction of the inductance and the capacitance, and that is obtained by increasing the switching frequency. So if you here, you know, on this shift we have maybe 3 mega of switching frequency, and we have a given inductance. But if you go up to 60 mega, or maybe 100 mega, the size of the inductor is much smaller. So you can put the inductor on the package. In that project, and we published that at ESSEC, I don't remember, some years ago. I don't remember that the year. But, you know, we had circuit was able to run with 120 mega of switching frequency. And with that solution, the value of the inductor was very small. The problem that we have when you go to very high speed is that the FT of the operational amplifier that you use, you know, to control the loop must be higher. And you have to invest a lot of power there. So what we have done with that study was to have a circuit that was doing the processing in the current domain to obtain a directed pulse using a current to pulse converter. So the idea was to have that the error is transformed into a current. And with that current, we discharge a capacitor. And when the, you know, the voltage across the capacitor is equal to a threshold of the comparator, we have the switching, we generate the pulse. So that, I don't know if I can find that. Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's good to know that, and if I didn't see on a slide, I probably missed a practical limit from the number of outputs versus efficiency.
No, not a practical limit. If I've seen, you know, for some application, even at eight output voltages.
8 output is feasible.
Yeah,
that's good. Last question: the kind of comparator topology you use on most of the DC-DC converter is a continuous time and basically on some continuous time differential stage or something more complex?
It's not a problem because you know you have the residual amplifier is increasing the error, so it's okay. What we have used in this circuit is a normal compared with a simple preamplifier in the latch. That was not complicated.
Cool. Okay. I don't know if we have some question from the audience here.
120 mega, you know, the speed of the comparator must be faster, but that is reasonable. There's not a big problem.
Yeah. New technology should be okay. So I received a message from Pedro. He sent you a affectuous hi, and he couldn't join today. He's in Europe right now, and he wanted to say hi to you and thank you for the presentation and be present on the conference. So thank you very much. I hope we can invite you in the next conference and probably in person, so and have you here in Argentina.
I hope so also.
That will be a pleasure.
Stay at home. I'm tired. Okay.
Thank you very much, Franco. Thank you. See you soon.